هذا العصر من أعلامه كن بهذا العصر من أعلامه.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in an ayah we all know, man the الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه. Who is the one who intercede with Allah except by his permission? Yani no one will be able to intercede for anyone else, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or other than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, except through the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Without the permission of Allah azza wa jal, does not matter who you are. And then that's why even a lot of the ulama and the mashayikh, they hate when a person jokes around like, Shaykh Allah khalik on the day of judgment, yani intercede for me. But the mashayikh and the ulama, they know how dangerous that statement is. Because the sheikh and the alim, he's doing his best to aslan get to Jannah. He doesn't know, is he going to be of people of paradise or the people of the hellfire, a'yadun billah. Taban, he hopes, everyone hopes, through their good deeds, through their actions, through their repentance, that they end up from the people of paradise. Everyone wants that. They hope through their actions that they will be through, they'll be the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they'll receive the intercession of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But can they guarantee that for their own souls? Of course not. Let alone them passing on to others or guaranteeing others that intercession. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, قُلْ ادْعُوا الَّذِينَ زَعَمْتُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ لَا يَمْلِكُونَ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا لَهُمْ وَمَا لَهُمْ فِيهِمَا مِنْ شِرْكٍ وَمَا لَهُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ ظَهِيرٍ وَلَا تَنْفَعُ الشَّفَاعَةُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا لِمَنْ أَذِنَ لَهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, call upon the ones that you believed, you claim besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they have some control of the universe. They do not control, they do not own mithqal dharra, even the amount of a little seed, a little atom, the smallest of things, the lightest of things in this universe, they don't control or have any power over, not in the heavens, nor on the earth, and they do not have any ownership or any partnership with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have no ability. وَلَا تَنْفَعُ الشَّفَاعَةُ, the intercession does not benefit a person with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِلَّا لِمَنْ أَذِنَ لَهُ, except for a person who Allah Azza wa Jal gives permission to. So it doesn't matter who this person is, who this individual is. If Allah Azza does not allow the intercession to happen, this intercession will not be allowed. And so that's why we are only allowed to seek it from the which the Sharia came with, and that is through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly, or through taking the means that Allah Azza promised will give allow a person to be interceded on behalf of, like sending the prayers on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Athaan, Sabah al-Masa, and others. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says regarding the shafa'a, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ يَوْمٌ لَا بَيْعٌ فِيهِ وَلَا خُلَّةٌ وَلَا شَفَاعَةٌ وَالْكَافِرُونَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. O you who believe, spend out of what we have provided for you before a day comes. There's no bay'ah. There's no trade on that day. You can't buy your way out of the hellfire. وَلَا شَفَاعَةٌ. And no, there's no intercession like, خلاص, I know this person, I know that person, and so just let me into the paradise. وَالْكَافِرُونَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. And the disbelievers, they indeed are the transgressors and the oppressors to themselves, طبعاً. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, يَوْمَئِذٍ لَا تَنْفَعُ الشَّفَاعَةُ إِلَّا مَنْ أَذِنَ لَهُ الرَّحْمَنُ وَرَضِيَ لَهُ قَوْلًا. On that day, in the day of judgment, the shafa'ah, the intercession, will not be accepted by anyone except to Allah Azza wa Jal allows and رَضِيَ لَهُ قَوْلًا. And Allah Azza accepts a speech from him. If a person does not have the idhn from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to intercede, he will not be allowed to. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want intercession for a particular individual, then he will never receive it, no matter who he is. We move on to the types of shafa'ah that will be on the day of judgment from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first one, and this is al-udhma, this is the great shafa'ah, الخاصة بنبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم من بين سائر إخوانه من الأنبياء والمرسلين صلوات الله عليهم أجمعين. This is for the day of judgment to start. This is for the حساب to start, when the people, they're scared and they go from prophet to prophet. The long hadith that we know, they go to this individual from the prophet, they go to that individual from the prophet, and everyone of the prophet عليه السلام say نفسي نفسي, and then they go to محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم and ask him to intercede on their behalf to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, فَأَتِي تَحْتَ الْعَرْشِ فَأَقَعُ سَجِدًا لِرَبِّي عَزَّ وَجَلْ ثُمَّ يَفْتَحُ اللَّهُ عَلَيَّ وَيُلْهِمُنِي مِنْ مَحَمِدِهِ وحسن ثنائي عليه شيئا لم يفتحه على احد من قبلي. فيقال يا محمد ارفع راسك، سل تعطى، اشفع تشفع. فاقول يا رب امتي امتي، يا رب امتي امتي، يا رب امتي امتي. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he allows the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day when the people come to him, for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say on that day, which we mentioned last week, is the dua that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saved for his ummah on the day of judgment. So he goes and does sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah azza wa jalla teaches him how to praise him in a way that no one else has been able to praise Allah azza wa jalla before. Allah azza wa jalla inspires and reveals to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ways to praise Allah Azza wa Jal and to make dua to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala in a way that no one has been able to do before. And Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says to the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, O Muhammad, raise your head, ask, and you'll be given ishfa, intercede on behalf, and you will be granted the permission to intercede. And so the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, Yani, my Lord, my my nation, my nation, my Lord, my nation, my nation, my Lord, my nation, my nation. And then there's other matters which we'll discuss inshaAllah in the coming types, because all of them are involved in the same narration. The first group of people to enter the paradise through the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are the ones who have no accountability, no hisab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, adkhil min ummatika man la hisab alayhi min al-bab al-ayman min abwab al-jannah wa hum sharaka'u an-nas fi ma siwahu min al-abwab. ثم قال والذي نفسي بيدي لما بين المصراعين من مصاريع الجنة كما بين مكة وهجر أو كما بين مكة وبصرة. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be told by Allah azza wa jal, enter into paradise those who have no accountability from the door of the right of paradise. These people who have no accountability, these are a very special group of people. And we know on the day of judgment, the people will be judged. Their good deeds will be brought, their bad deeds will be brought. From amongst the people that will be brought on the day of judgment are people who will not be questioned. They'll be allowed to enter the paradise without any questioning whatsoever. And the Prophet ﷺ said they will enter the door of paradise, the size of this door of paradise is like what is between Makkah and Hajar, or Makkah and Busra. There's two places, Basra and Busra. Basra is in Iraq. Busra is in Al-Sham, in Syria. Now Busra is in Al-Sham, in Syria. So the door of paradise is like what is between Mecca and Busra, which is still a city to today, a place in Syria. But a lot of people, they get mixed up in some of the narrations. And that's why the tadbit of it is so important. And you, in a lot of books of hadith, you find that there. Now between Basra and Busra, and where they're different in different narrations. So these are the people that will enter the paradise without, these are the first group that will have that intercession. النوع الثاني والثالث من الشفاعة شفاعته صلى الله عليه وسلم في القيام قد تساوت حسناتهم وسيئاتهم. The second group of people that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم intercede for are the ones who the حسنات and the سيئات were the same. The حسنات and the سيئات were the same. And they stand where on the day of judgment? Al-A'raf. I'm a place called Al-A'raf. These are the people who they didn't have enough good to go to the paradise, nor did they have enough bad to go to the hellfire. فَيَشْرَعُ فِيهِمْ لِيَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ وَفِي أَقْوَامٍ آخَرِينَ قَدْ أُمِرَ بِهِمْ إِلَى النَّارِ أَلَّا يَدْخُلُوهَا. So these people, the Prophet ﷺ intercedes for them and they enter the paradise. And another group of people that were destined, عَيَذُ بِاللَّهِ, to go to the hellfire, but the Prophet ﷺ intercedes on their behalf and they are able to go to the paradise. Taban, these are not everyone that was destined to go. These are again the ones who Allah Azza wa Jal permitted the Prophet to intercede for and was pleased for them to receive that intercession. Regarding the first of these two types, those who their hasanat and the sayyat were the same. This is a stark reminder for every single one of us to never belittle any good that you do. Because you don't know, maybe all that one istighfar that you done that gave you the advantage, where your hasanat were more than your sayyi'at, or that one extra salah, or that extra dollar that you gave in sadaqah, or that time that you lowered your gaze, or that you withheld your anger. Allahu alam, what it was from the good that you done that made your scale of good deeds heavier than the scale of bad deeds on the day of judgment. So never belittle any good that you do from acts that you actually do physically or things from belief and holding yourself from bad, etc. النوع الرابع, the fourth type, شفاعته صلى الله عليه وسلم في رفع درجات من يدخل الجنة فيها فوق ما كان يقتديه ثواب عماله. The fourth type is for people that enter paradise to go to higher levels in paradise. And this is generosity from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is kindness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala towards his slaves. That people will enter the paradise and their actions permit them to go to a certain level. But what takes them to higher levels, there are certain matters which you're allowed to get to higher levels. For example, someone in your family was on a higher level of paradise. Someone in your family was on a higher level. In order for you not to be separated in paradise, Allah Azza wa Jalla allows you, as the family of that person, to be raised to the rank of that particular individual. Another way for a person to be raised in paradise is through the intercession of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, for them to go to the higher levels. النوع الخامس شفاعته في أقوام أن يدخلوا الجنة بغير حساب. And this is from the one that we mentioned in the first type, that the Prophet ﷺ will intercede for people for them to go into the paradise without any questioning. And there's one very famous companion of the Prophet ﷺ who, when the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that there will be these people, he allowed them, he made dua, he said to the Prophet ﷺ, ask Allah that I'm from them. And he was permitted, the Prophet ﷺ made dua for him and his dua was answered. Ukasha, and some said Ukasha. Naam. There's two ways of saying his name. And this is where the famous name comes from, Sabaqaka biha Ukasha. That Ukasha, it became a proverb that Ukasha was came before you. Naam. Because another companion also asked the Prophet ﷺ, he got asked Allah also for me. And the Prophet ﷺ said that Ukasha beat you too. The Prophet ﷺ said, وَعَدْنِي رَبِّي أَنْ يُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةِ مِنْ أُمَّةِ سَبْعِينَ أَلْفًا بِلَا حِسَابٍ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا عَذَابٍ مَعَ كُلِّ أَلْفٍ سَبْعُونَ أَلْفًا وَثَلَاثُ حَثَيَاتٍ مِنْ حَثَيَاتِ رَبِّي. My Lord has promised me that he will enter from my ummah 70,000 with no account, with no questioning or punishment. Whenever you hear the term 7 or 70 or 700 or 7,000, it's not limited to that number. Okay, this is a figure of speech that the Arabs had, where it meant a lot. Like we say, yani whether you say it 100 or a million times, we don't need literally 100 or a million. Naam, this is metaphoric to mean a large number. So 7 is one number, 70 is obviously a larger number, 700 is a more larger number, 7,000 is a larger number, 70,000 is a larger number, and this is just a figure of speech that the Arabs had. It doesn't mean that it's specific, only this number is allowed. Some of the ulama said it's only this number, but the correct, wallahu alam, yani based on the language of the Arabs, is that 7 and its offshoots, naam, they just metaphoric to mean a large number. One part that many people, they forget from this hadith because it comes in other narrations like this one, reported in Ahmed and others, is that the Prophet ﷺ said, مَعْ كُلِّ أَلْفٍ سَبْعُونَ أَلْفًا. From every 1,000 of the 70,000, Allah Azza wa Jal adds another 70,000. Okay, for every 1,000 of this 70,000, Allah Azza wa Jal adds another 70,000. So the number is a massive number of people that will enter the paradise without any punishment or questioning. And in the other narrations that make it clearer, they're not mentioned here. Who are these people? These are people who have complete tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have complete tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't seek treatment through al-kay, which is through treatment through burning. If a person has, for example, an open wound, they don't, in the olden days, they used to heat up the metal and put it on themselves, and that would stop all the bleeding and get rid of bacteria, etc. Even though it's halal, but it's disliked to treat like that. And they're not pessimistic in things that are not allowed to be pessimistic in. There's probably a better word, but like what they used to do, for example, before a tiyara, where they would let a bird go, and if it goes to the left, they say, no, we're not going to go on this trip. Or if they see like a black cat, they say, oh, we've seen a black cat, khalas, someone's going to die. Or don't walk under the ladder, it's bad luck. This is at the shaum. And this is not allowed. So they don't believe in that. Haram to believe in. ولا يستقون. They do not seek ruqya from others. So even though it's allowed, you're allowed to seek ruqya from others, but it removes you from those higher levels of iman and respect and honor. Now, it's not haram, but it's not the best thing to do. جيد. If a person needs it, خير إن شاء الله, it's not a problem. If a person offers it, خير إن شاء الله, no problem. But the best thing when it comes to ruqya is for a person to do it on themselves. For a person to put their reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do ruqya on themselves. Not everyone, unfortunately, is capable, and that's why some people, they need to seek assistance from others. If a person is in a situation, again, it's halal and he's allowed to do it. And some of the ulama said, because the Prophet advised Aisha and others to seek ruqya. Some of the ulama said, which is again a possibility, is that they do not do ruqya in haram. They don't do ruqya with haram. Like some people, they get to a magician, a sahir, and they ask for him to cure them. Or they try and get rid of magic through haram means. Now for a person, he should try obviously on himself, doing himself, beginning with believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doing good deeds, saying the afkar in the sabah, in the masa, in the morning, in the evening, reading your mu'awwidhat, the surah like kul a'udhu bil falaq, kul a'udhu bin nas, add on to it, kul huwallahu ahad, that protect you from the evil, the afkar before you sleep, etc. There are a lot of afkar a person should do that protect a person from that evil. Now, but make a part of your day-to-day process, and inshallah azza wa jal, no harm will affect you, inshallah. And if a person ever did come across a time where he needed ruqya, try on yourself first and foremost. If for whatever reason you need to seek treatment, that's external to yourself, no issue, but go to someone who's trusted, the Sheikh Jazallahu Khairan, he helps out with ruqya. Go to someone who is trusted, who uses the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and no issue, inshallah. النوع السادس, the sixth type, الشفاعة في تخفيف العذاب عمن يستحقه كشفاعته في عمه أبي طالب. The sixth type is the شفاعة of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم for those that deserve punishment. نعم, for those that are in the hellfire to have a reduced punishment from the believers. There's one exception for the disbelievers. Who's that? The uncle of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, Abu Talib, I thought you said Abu Lahab. Now, Abu Talib. Now, Abu Talib, there's one exception for him. Even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the author, rahimahullah, Hafidhullah mentions it, فَمَتَنْفَعُمْ شَفَاعَةُ الشَّافِعِينَ, that in terms of the disbelievers, the shafa'ah, the intercession of those that intercede on the day of judgment will not benefit the disbelievers. This is am, okay, this is general. And the khas, that which is specific, came in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that will be the only intercession for the disbelievers. For his uncle Abu Talib, that he will have two sandals from fire that will make his brains boil. Allah knows. The seventh type is the Prophet ﷺ interceding for the opening of the door of paradise. The Prophet ﷺ said, آتي باب الجنة يوم القيامة فأستفتح فيقول الخازن من أنت فأقول محمد فيقول بك أمرت لا أفتح لأحد قبلك. The Prophet ﷺ said that he will come on the day of judgment to the door of paradise, and he will ask for it to be opened, and the gatekeeper will ask, who are you? And he will say, I am Muhammad. And he will be said, you are the only one I was commanded to open up the door for. لا أفتح لأحد قبلك. I will not open to anyone before you. النوع الثامن, and this is the last type mentioned here, that هي شفعته صلى الله عليه وسلم في أقوام ماتوا على دين الإسلام وأوبقتهم كثرة الآثام فيشفع لهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ليخرجوا من النار. These are people who are in the fire. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم will intercede on their behalf for them to be removed from the fire. But how long were they in there for? What torment did they go through, etc.? These are things that sometimes when people hear about the intercession and hear about what the Prophet ﷺ will be given on the Day of Judgment from that virtue, they have a little bit of tasahul. They have a little bit of yani khalas. It's if I go to the Hellfire, the Prophet ﷺ will intercede for me. We should never, ever, ever think like that. Yani anyone who thinks that the Hellfire is nothing, firstly, you've fallen into one of the traits of the Yahud. That they said, it's only going to be ayam ma'dudat. Yani it's only going to be counted number of days. It's nothing. Basita. I'll go to the hellfire and then I'll go to the paradise. We say in this dunya, you know the candle that your wife has in the house for a nice smell? Or maybe that you have, mashallah, for your wife when you have dinner. Yani some of the brothers, mashallah, know. If you were to get your hand and just put your hand over that, yani for 10 minutes, it's impossible for you to do. That candle that it's there for, yani warmth in the room, it's there to look nice, it's there to smell nice. You're not able to. And that's not made for punishment. It's made for, yani, to bring joy. You wouldn't be able to keep your hand for 10 minutes over. How then, a'yadun billah, you're going to be in a hellfire, which is 70 times hotter than the fire in this dunya, and it's not one little flame, it's an engulfing fire from top and from the bottom and from the left, from the right and from the left. It's not, it's there made for punishment. Its fuel is human beings, not a piece of string. But some people, unfortunately, they belittle the hellfire and they act as if it's absolutely nothing and it's not a problem, and even if I was to go, I'll be alright, inshallah. No, abadan. We should never belittle the hellfire, not even for wallah, a microsecond. Now, I'm not even for a microsecond. So some of these people, they say, khalas, I'll go there. No, you don't work for that. The Prophet is informing us of a reality that will happen. It doesn't mean that you go and work to be from these people or hope to be from these people. No, you want to be from the people that the first time that enter the paradise without any judgment. They don't even get asked by Allah Azza wa Jal. They just, because of their good deeds and the tawakkul of Allah SWT, etc., they're able to enter the paradise without any punishment or questioning whatsoever. May Allah Azza wa Jalla help us in seeking knowledge and give us the strength and the sincerity to continue and reach those high levels. Next week, inshallah, we'll continue with some other people that we'll be able to intercede on the day of judgment.